Okay, we've got minutes to approve from one. And we gotta sign some from the sex.
Have any problems on my motion to approve?
That's for the 20th?
For the 20th.
Well, again, the only thing that I'll mention is that Dan is deputy fiscal officer. I think he was actually already.
Yeah, so we're just gonna line that out.
Right.
Initially, here it is.
Okay, I'll second it.
PJ?
Yes.
Gene?
Yes.
Mike?
Yes.
And these have been approved, they just need signatures. We schedule reports for the two meetings, and at this one, which is the first meeting of the month, we got Mr. Frank Kitko, zoning inspector.
Well, again, you should all have a report from March. But basically, we issued 9 permits, 8 of which were accessory buildings, either over or under 200 square feet. And then we did have 1 fence. That makes the 9 permits. I'm sure probably most of you in this room have seen the activity on Munn Road next to the existing gravel pit, just so you know. There'll be one there as well.
One what?
Gravel pit.
Gravel pit. That's Dan. That's the first one.
I have the preliminary. It is a conditional use that, as you know, there are very few things that we can do conditional-wise to mining operation, because it falls under the state jurisdiction for the most part. Because it's on a county road, can't really deny them the right to use Munn Road, it's a county road. If people have been calling, that's what's going on. They will be coming in for conditional use when they get the rest of it. We told them we didn't want them to come through to the Board of Appeals till they had their state permit. But I do know that they have applied for everything, so. So I just wanted that's all I have.
We got a letter today, came to the fiscal officer, from ODNR, and it's liability insurance, and it all pertains to that gravel pit. Can I just hand this off to you if you guys got a file going?
Frank?
Yes, sir.
Have you noticed the house next to the Auburn Inn on the south side of it?
Yes.
It's a pigsty.
Yes.
Worse than a pigsty.
We've been working with them, and I have been told that the Auburn Inn is going to purchase that property and tear the house down and expand their much-needed expansion of their parking lot.
I'm under the impression that already transferred.
It did.
I didn't know for sure if it transferred it, but I know that they were. Discussions were there, and they've been. The family has been trying to, working on getting stuff cleaned out. But as you may or may not know, Mr. and Mrs. May were
collected a lot of stuff.
They collected.
It's a nice way of saying it.
I was trying to be diplomatic in how I said it, but I know that at one point there were newspapers in that house. Stacked up, and I think it was all the way back to the 40s. So.
I'm sorry, I wasn't as diplomatic as you, but anybody who's watched me for the last 20 years, I have no filter.
Right,
it's a pigsty.
I've been working with trying to get it organized and talking with the family, especially since Ralph has passed away. Yes.
So we shouldn't have to worry about that much longer, then?
No,
is that what you're saying?
Hopefully it'll all be cleaned up shortly. I know they've been working, but it's tough sometimes. I don't know. Though, I knew Ralph real well, but I did know the internal workings of the family at all. So, you know, I don't know if it was a close family or, you know, or anything.
Well, yeah, it's got new owners, and I'm sure they'll do what they want to do with it, so. Any other questions for Frank, zoning related? All right, thank you, Mr. Kitco.
You're welcome.
Emmerich Gordon, our highway superintendent, is in tonight, and we've got some stuff.
He's in the house.
Yeah, we're here, yeah, okay. Auburn Township Road Department report for March 2023. March saw 5 weather events that required 8 rounds of plowing and or salting. 245 tons of de-icing material was used for the month. The total use for 2022-2023 winter season was 1,319 tons of road salt. And looking back at our records here, that was the third lightest winter since we've been keeping track the last 17 years. 2008-09, 2010-11, and 2011-12 were about 100 tons lighter for those winters. So. But it was February, it was very light, 150 tons of material. The remaining balance of 1,400 tons of road salt will be purchased and stored prior to the contract end date of May 31st, 2023. And you should see a requisition up there for the balance, I believe, of the road salt. There should be a requisition there.
Yeah, right here on top.
Yeah, okay. And we got to get that in by the 31st.
Yeah.
And I did talk with Morton directly, and we won't extend it. So that's our final belief. There were 2 high wind events, actually one on April 1st. They took down trees, wires, utility poles. Road department was kept busy clearing roads, setting signage and barricades for multiple road closures. We did have to split up in 2 teams this time. We did have, Chief, I think there was 3 road closures, 3 or 4 the first weekend, and we had 3 or 4 again this last weekend.
That's correct.
Yeah. And I think we did have power backup restored for everybody within 3 days, I think it was this time. So we are taking the winter service equipment off of some of the trucks. I'll still have a couple prepared in case we do have snow. We're going to go out and we'll start attacking some of the ditches here. I did talk to Peter. We have a really big tree on Bailey Road over there in some of the old French property that did reside within our right of way. And I think we're going to need to clear that one up there. And also, I know we had a visitor last week, and I went on Frank's Road there. We did look at some trees there. I'm going to have my tree guy come in, and we'll target some trees there.
None of those trees went down during the storm. I was thinking about that.
No, sir. No. The one big ash did split in half. And
these ash trees are all dead.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so we'll take care of these
trees. You know, we get past the bid opening and whatnot here. Maybe we ought to do a little tour, you and me, Sunday, and to put a little package together for
some
quotes. Because they're all coming down eventually.
They are eventually.
One way or another. Maybe Wednesday.
Yeah, cold patching and roads continued. The roads were re-rated for the updating of the database, and I'm anxious to get those figures back to Nancy. I do have about a dozen more roads out there that have holes here and there that we'll be patching over the course of the next couple of weeks. And then we will use the cold match patch material until the hot mix asphalt plants open up. Drainage updates for the capital improvement projects began with the removal of several trees that were involved in the drainage channels and blocking the inlet outlet across culvert pipes scheduled for replacement on Bridge Creek Drive. The anticipated end date for the cross culvert drainage construction is May 31st, and we do have 2 different companies there that we'll be working with that you guys took care of last week. What we will do, Nancy and I will send out some letters this week here to notify the residents that there'll be some small inconveniences there. We will have to keep one lane open, and each company does have steel plates to plate the road, so we can keep the lane open. Sign up is open at the Geauga County Department on Aging for senior trash pickup June 1st and 2nd. And you guys have the kind of Ohio stuff up there for And don't forget April 22nd, which is coming up here, Earth Day roadside cleanup. where Chef Troyan exhibits his culinary expertise at the Griller Grill and Hot Dogs for All. So that's what I got for you this month.
Okay, while you're here, Emmerich.
Yes, sir.
We've got a resolution 2016. This is for participation in the SALT program. We'll just go over while you're on the clock here.
Yeah.
Township hereby submits a written agreement to participate in ODOT's annual road SALT bid in accordance with ORC. Following terms and conditions, or bound by all terms and conditions established by ODOT in the contract. Upon the director of ODOT signing of the road SALT contract, shall effectively form a contract between the awarded SALT supplier and the subdivision. Plus, we agree to be solely responsible for resolving claims or disputes. I'm doing the Reader's Digest version of this, by the way. The subdivision's electronic order for road salt will be in the amount the political subdivision agrees to purchase from its awarded salt supplier at the delivered bid price per ton. That's going to stay the same, about 2,000?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
2,000, they're plus or minus 10%. Q was plus or minus 20.
Yeah, okay, right there. We agree to purchase a minimum of 90% of its electronically submitted salt quantities. Place orders with and directly pay the awarded supplier. And if we want to get out of the contract, I don't anticipate that. And therefore, be it ordained by the following authorized persons, that's us. Participation in this agreement with ODOT, I will make a motion to adopt that resolution 2023-16.
I'll second.
EJ?
Yes.
Gene?
Yes.
Mike?
Yes.
Oh, okay, you got it. That's fine.
And then what we have, PJ, I still have 300 to 400 tons left of the 2021-2022 salt contract. We have the entirety of last year's contract, and we will have the entirety of this year's contract in our back pocket. So there will be no salt shortage. So, unless they can't deliver. No, I have no control over that.
Supply chain?
I just saw them here, too, some quotes from Penn, Ohio, who's been doing a good job providing us the dumpsters for a roadside cleanup day at the end of this month, and then it's not at the end of this month, what is it?
The 22nd, DJ.
22nd,
yeah.
And then our cleanup day, first weekend in June. Emmerich and I looked them over. There's approximately, like everything else, apart from, of course, everything's up about 20-25%. Obviously, there's no, this is just a roadside ditch cleanup, so that's on us to pay for that one. But do we want to readdress any costs at the June 6th or the early June event?
About $7 and $10.
We'll get it out. You know, it's early, but to look at it, it's going to cost, you know, a fair amount more.
Your sheets are already printed.
Yeah, they are. Those haven't changed for about, I don't know, 25 years. But yeah, prices are, like everything else, going up everywhere, so I don't know, give it some thought.
This has never been really a big profit score for us.
No, we're never going to make money. That's not the goal.
It's just to break even. Maybe we should put that on our beginning of the year.
We don't even break even here. But it provides a service to the residents that I think is greatly appreciated. So, you know.
See, if we make it, you know, 10 and 15, it'd be a lot easier to break change.
I actually heard that recommendation today. I did. I don't know. Give it some thought. It's...
If you make it too high, they'll be doing what they used to do in the old days and just drop it off
the ditch
the night before.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. And the other, that's the other reason is why we always had a fee on it, because if it's free, then you're gonna attract all your neighbors from across the county line and everything else, so, but I don't know, give it some thought, it's, if you wanna start offsetting a little bit of that.
Yeah, yeah, like I said, I have no problem raising it a little bit, I don't think anybody else, I mean, a lot of people, you know, they'll give you $7, they'll give you the $10 and let you keep it anyway, they're, people are pretty generous and pretty happy with the program.
I have something for Emmerich before he goes.
I'm not going nowhere.
I've been saving this for you since March 7th. It's an article in the Wall Street Journal, as we were talking about our purchase of our new big truck. Well, there's a small town here that's doing the same thing, like many municipalities buying a new truck, and they've been having contests to name the new truck. And maybe this is something you wanna do, like this town has like Jennifer Snowbez, Hall and Totes. Hall and Oates for you people that weren't born in the... Truck Norris. That's Chuck Norris again.
Wasn't Cleveland doing this as well? I heard this, eh?
The Big Lebowski.
Yeah.
Again, a movie to... Anyway, I saved that for you.
Sure.
I thought if nothing else, you'd let, enjoy reading it.
Yeah, I'll take that, thank you.
Maybe we could have a contest here in Auburn, because we could get a lot of names before the time that truck ever gets ready to go.
Okay. Dan wants a motion, and I will make it to accept the quotes from Penn, Ohio for the cleanup days.
I'll second.
EJ?
Yes.
Gene?
Yes.
Mike?
Yes.
All right, the other thing, Emmerich, before we let you go, is make a mention that we got a bid opening up there Friday morning, 10:05. For...
That'll be here.
Various roads, yeah, right here, yeah. Any questions for Emmerich Gordon about the roads? Thanks, Emmerich. We'll do our reports, we'll start at the other end with Mike Tryon.
Well, I don't have much to report, haven't been out of town for the last week, but we might as well go into the...
Fire department.
Yeah, we can do the fire department resolutions. First thing we're doing, and again, these changes were made, are being made, because we had some ARPA funds designated to the fire department, and we had specific uses in there, part of which was the air tanks, and since they got a sizable grant, they don't need the money for that, and I had told them, you know, we had some other projects too that they could use it on. So what I wanted to do is to change the terminology on the resolution for that ARPA funding, and then I had to change the fire department contract to match that verbiage. And then the third thing that's going to happen on this is that the original resolution that we had for the ARPA funding for the fire department, which is resolution 2022-47, is we will rescind that resolution and then replace it with the new resolution, which is the 2023-15. So, first thing I want to do is I think we'll sign the contract. Okay, we discussed this at the last meeting, but I'll go over the changes. And here's the new amended section 3. Trustees agree to pay corporation for such services a sum of $1,290,453.47. Of $239,689 is from the American Rescue Plan. What it's going to be used for is A, replacement of outdated mobile and portable communication equipment. B is replacement of self-contained breathing apparatus cylinders, harnesses, face plates, and accessories, replacement of rapid intervention team packs with associated face plates and accessories. C, updated firefighting turnout gear ensembles to current standards. And D will be acquisition of battery-operated emergency rescue tools, i.e. cutters, spreaders, rams, pumps, and accessories, replacing the existing power equipment. So what I'll do is, Dan, you have the original down there?
Yeah.
Okay, so you want to sign that? Is there two copies there to sign?
Nancy said she was going to set them up for you, so I don't know if she's got it.
Because typically we have two copies, one we keep, one we give you. So if you got those, Dan, we can get them signed, and you guys can sign, and then we'll go on to the rescinding the original ARPA. Oh yeah, at least 20. I tried saving this stuff a long time. That just came wrong.
Just make us a copy of that after the meeting?
Yeah. Send us a copy of it?
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug.
Thanks, guys.
Yep. Thank you.
So, yeah, okay.
I hope you own a copy, right?
Yes. Okay. All right. What we're going to do then is make a motion to rescind Resolution 2022-47. Dated 12/19/22, ARPA expenditures $239,689.87.
You made the motion?
Yes.
Second.
What is that now?
This resolution, this one. Wait a minute, no, that's the replacement. He wants to rescind.
Rescinding 2022-47.
2022-47. This is all ARPA technicality stuff.
This is the
Mike made the motion, I second.
This one. EJ?
Yes.
Gene?
Yes.
Oh. Mike?
Yes.
Sure.
I'd love to read the exact same thing that we've read as the normal body. I'm only going to read the part specifying what the use of the funds is for. In this case, whereas the board has identified a project which in judgment of the board qualifies as a permitted use of the ARPA funds in direct support of governmental services, which consists of the following: replacement of outdated mobile and portable communication equipment, replacement of self-contained breathing apparatus, cylinders, harnesses, faceplates, and accessories, replacement of rapid intervention team air packs with associated face pieces and accessories, acquisition of battery-operated emergency rescue tools, i.e. cutters, spreaders, ramps, pumps, and accessories, to replace the existing powered equipment, and updated firefighting turnout gear ensembles to current standards. And again, this is going to be for the exact same amount as the last one, which is a total of $239,689.87.
Yeah, same amount.
Motion to adopt resolution 2023-15.
I'll second.
Yeah, wait a minute. We're off by 10 cents on. Pretty good catch, man. You got a dime?
Yeah.
Okay, the resolution reads.
And that's what I wrote the check for.
Yeah, $239,689.87. The contract reads.
$239,689.97.
Really?
Yeah, give us a dime.
Okay. I can easily change the contact, bring it back for you guys for resigning. Whatever. Easy go.
Well, we can just, we don't want to change this amount, so.
Sorry, you drop a dime off here.
Drop a dime off.
Drop a dime.
Drop a dime.
Dan loves hearing that.
It was that UAM computer again. He made a motion.
He made a motion. Somebody
I seconded it.
Are we going to work around this dime? What are we going to do here?
Oh, we're going to leave the dime on the resolution. They're going to change the contract.
Okay.
And bring it back.
All right.
Who seconded it?
I seconded it.
Anybody got a dime out?
No.
I'm so poor they won't take my cash.
That's sad.
EJ.
Yes.
Gene.
Yes.
Mike.
Yes.
I'll be up here with my tin cup waiting for that dime.
Oh.
So they're going to reduce the contract.
So that we should have it. This is the original. What else you got, Mike?
That's all we've got.
Mr. Troy? Hi, Mike.
That's it.
Good question. Since we have the opportunity to have all four people of the board here, getting back to the Volunteer Firefighters Dependents Fund and the letter that we usually get, didn't yet, we're trying to catch up with that now. You guys, according to Nancy, elected Mr. Troy and Mr. Kavanaugh for the two board representatives. Okay. And our fire company elected Mr. Desmond and myself as our two members. According to the terms of the ORC on this, we have to elect a fifth member to serve as like a citizen representative of that board. Do we want to take care of that tonight? Do you guys want some time to research this? What's your pleasure? I have a candidate, a neighbor who's willing to do it. But again, I don't want to pull anything out of the closet real quick here for you.
Well, I think you guys can go ahead and pull the fifth person. We just have always established, you know, two of the trustees, the chairman and the vice chairman.
Yeah, okay. I think there's an annual meeting.
One annual meeting is setting this fifth person.
Yeah, so, okay. Once again, this is in the worst case scenario.
That is correct.
It's a disfigurement, a death.
Disability or death is a very small one-time payment, or it's like $300 a month. I would just hate to have them kick it back because we don't have
all of the T's crossing I's.
I've been around long enough that I think our representatives at the time were Randy Puckett and I think maybe Damon Braun.
Right.
I don't think there was ever a claim, if I'm correct.
That's correct.
Let's hope to keep it that way. But yeah, we might as well, you know, set it up for 7:20 some night.
Okay.
On a Monday up here and
all right.
Get that done. I mean, Dan and I have to do a records retention meeting at some point as well. So there's
perfect.
The state requires all this.
Okay.
Paperwork. That's it. Where?
All right. Your next meeting, right, Doug?
I'm not here for the next one.
Okay. We'll do it in a month.
I'm not here for the next one. We say all these.
All right. I will coordinate that with
Nancy. Firefighters Dependence
Fund.
Yeah. It's the acronym again. It's initials.
Yeah.
All right, but we'll get that. We'll get that out of
Thank you.
What do you got, Jane?
I really don't have that much. I just want to thank again the road department for the work they did on the weekend. I know I called Emmerich from out of town. I was told I had a tree across Edward Lane that unfortunately came from my yard. And, so thank you. And at least pushing it to the side. I didn't know if there was an event at the party center down there or not. But
your wife was actually out there.
Was she?
Yeah,
really. That's sad because my wife is legally blind and you don't want to see her with anything sharp in her hands.
Yeah. Well, we'll be out chipping brush. We'll get that out the next
day.
In the next couple of days.
Thank you.
Yeah.
The other thing is the weather starts to dry up. The temperature's getting warmer. We have to start thinking about what we're going to do in the cemetery here and get that going. And also the next phase in the park. But again, we need a couple more good weeks of dry weather to dry things out, and we should be ready to move on some of this stuff. And, the only other thing I have is, did you guys get a chance to look at this letter from our attorney, assistant prosecuting attorney, and the review for the fence at the cemetery?
Yeah, I'm actually initiated that, and I know I'm kind of one wolf on that, but I also sat in on a seminar down at the convention on how to spend ARPA funds.
Uh-huh.
All right, so there's a standard allowance resolution we were to have adopted prior to making any expenditures out of that. Now, even though in the minutes when we ordered this, remember we tried to get it in before Memorial Day last year.
Right.
And supply chain, it never got put in until August or September. All right. When we got that standard allowance verbiage from the prosecutor's office, we did it right away as soon as we got it. Mm-hmm. But this bill got paid before then.
And did we designate that bill coming out of ARPA funds?
We did, but by law, per Chrissy Ryan's letter right there, you had to have adopted that standard allowance first, that standard allowance resolution. So I'm looking into this, Gina. I'm the one that started this. It's going to get seen at some point. We're aware of it. We didn't lose any money. It's just the money's going to have to come from a different pot.
Okay.
And Chrissy's on it. We sent her all the support information today, along with a letter describing, two paragraphs, like describing what happened and why.
Okay. The second quote she has in there about, you know, signing quotes without terms of conditions associated with the work being done. Have we ever done that? We ever signed a check to anybody or a quote relay without knowing exactly what the work conditions we were paying for?
No.
Did you read her quote there?
No, I did not.
It says, I also want to note that general practice of just signing quotes without terms of conditions associated with the work being done is not an acceptable practice. And
I don't know.
I don't think we've ever done that for anybody, have we?
I'd like to see
Okay,
that.
I just wondered if anybody else questioned that.
Yeah, I'd like to see the full instance of that, actually.
Okay, that's all I have.
All right, I got a couple things. One is, and this was another resolution that I've been running some information back and forth with Middlefield Bank, and as we've discussed, we're going to We paid for the cab and chassis with ARPA funds, but the build-out of that truck, which still isn't available, we're still waiting for the actual equipment. We're going to finance through Middlefield Bank. We've got a couple of comps, and they were by far lower interest, and the terms were better. So I'm going to read this one, it's real short. Board of Trustees met in regular session today. Present were all three of us, and I'm going to move for the adoption of this resolution that Township authorizes either myself and or Dan Matsko to obtain the loan for Judco equipment for $102,860 through Middlefield Banking Company. So I made the motion.
I'll second.
PJ?
Yes.
Gene?
Yes.
Mike?
Yes.
And the other thing, we got another letter came in today. And it is here. Through USDA wants to put up 6 tree-hanging insect traps in the wooded area.
I'm all
adjacent to the northern edge of the park.
You can show them where to put them.
And then they're going to...
They've done this in the past.
Yeah.
Did we ever get a letter what kind of bugs we got here?
Not what kind of bugs, but yes, they did set traps in our park.
Well, they said they'll actually tell us at the end of the year what kind of bugs we got.
They're going to monitor it and everything.
Every couple of weeks.
Identifiers at the Carnegie Museum of Natural History in Pittsburgh are going to do the specimen identification.
The gist of this is that wood boring,
Carnegie Museum in Pittsburgh.
Isn't there a certain insect that they're concerned about?
Probably the wood borer. Those lantern fly things.
Well, they don't mention that, but they answer the wood borer.
If granted permission, we can provide you the data of the identified target insects collected from the locations.
I want to know that.
I do, too. All right, so here's a motion to give permission to USDA to carry out that program.
A second. Do we have to have Nancy notify them that we're happily to do that?
We got an email. So
all your bees
there.
Are chipped, right? So they know where to return.
I don't want my bees in that trap.
PJ?
Yes.
Gene?
Yes.
Mike?
Yes.
There's what they look like.
Yep. Yeah. Unless there's honey in there or something sweet, that bees ain't going for it.
Send them my way for the fruit tree.
Here, I already got 3 copies of this.
All right, that's all I...
No, I was just praying for that.
Yeah, we're going down into what remains of the agenda. And we've got a zoning amendment that's been passed, and we've got to set a public hearing tonight. Frank, could you give us a once-over as to what that pertains to?
Well, it's just some changes that they've been working on. And believe it or not, I think that this time around the Planning Commission is pretty much on board with what I think they have asked to change a little bit of wording, but other than that, this commission has been moving along, changing things, or, like you put in charging stations for electric vehicles, knowing that it's going to come, trying to control it a little bit, and different things like that. So it'll be just kind of cleaning up the wording and everything. I don't think there's anything major in it, I know Dave Dietrich's worked with them on some things. There is a discussion about permitted uses versus conditional uses, and here again, if you make something conditional, then you have to develop or establish a set of conditions. And so if you make every business a conditional use, then you come up with a couple hundred conditions possibly. Certain things you cannot control. You cannot control operating hours beyond a reasonable point. Just mining operations, that's one of the things that we kind of control. But you can't not permit them from running on Saturday because It's a construction trade related business, and they run 6 days a week, five and a half, 6 days a week. You can make them stop at a certain point as long as it's reasonable. But you cannot prohibit them from working like half, at least half a day on Saturday, or you can shut them down like at 4 or 5 o'clock and start them at 7 o'clock, you know, things like that. But you gotta be reasonable in your. So there's been some discussion, and I think they, I just shared with them, I said, if you start making everything conditional, then you have to start coming up with all kinds of conditions. Mike, you remember that.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think we want to do that, you know.
They want some permitted uses, that's what.
Right. Make them permitted or prohibited, one or the other, you know. But I will review it more, and I'll be glad to come to the public hearing if anybody has any questions.
Is that why the target thing or the gun range?
Well, yeah, we kind of a mixed emotion, Bob, but it's hard to regulate them if they're outside. We don't have any problems inside shooting, but outside shooting, it's very hard. We don't have the expertise, you know, and we have to rely on the sheriff's office and that type of stuff. Even inside, but inside is a lot easier to control than outside. We do have one. I don't know if they actually still exist, but on Monroe next to Poonies, that has always been an outdoor shooting range, but I don't know how active it is. You know. But we have shooting, I'm sure everybody in this room on Saturday and Sunday hear shooting throughout the township, throughout the county, you know. And there's not a whole lot we can do with individuals, but ranges are a little tricky, so.
You remember years ago down on Bartholomew, the guys that owned that farm would come out from the city, shoot from Friday night to Sunday night, and the lady had the horse farm across the street and said her horses were just.
Yeah.
There were a lot of shooting
that
clubs.
That was.
Quite a lot of shooting clubs out here.
Oh,
40 years ago.
Yeah.
A lot.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so we're on the clock with this. This amendment was presented to us on the 24th. This board has to schedule a public hearing within 30 days, which leaves April 17th as the only one available. I'm not going to be here that night, so I'm going to let you guys set up the time.
You want to do it before our regular season? Is that when we
usually
do that before?
That's usually how it's
done. So why don't we schedule it for, meeting start at 7:30. Let's do it. How much time do you think we're going to need for that, Frank?
Probably half hour.
Half hour. Let's schedule our meeting at 7 o'clock then to do that, and our regular meeting at 7:30.
Okay, one second.
Is that a motion?
Yep.
Yeah, a second.
What is this?
That's for Jane. That's just a FYI.
And what date is that?
April 17th. So
next meeting.
Prior to the next regular meeting.
Next meeting.
DJ?
I'll vote yes.
Jane?
Yes.
Mike?
Yes.
So we'll be able to vote on that resolution with just the two trustees.
Yeah. Okay, I got out of order here, and we got a report, and I know Dan's got a lot of stuff to give us tonight, too.
All right, I issued 17 warrants and one electronic payment for a total of $288,413.99. I also have a requisition to join the Ohio Association of Public Treasurers and attend a 5-day training program in Sandusky, June 5th through the 9th. Total estimated cost for training, lodging, meals, and mileage, $1,600.
In our budget, we always set aside travel and expenses, it's there, so we don't, do we need a motion for this, Dan?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either. It's part of the job nowadays.
And I received an email from the Opioids Implementation Administrator, National Opioid Settlements Implementation Administrator, regarding apparently some litigation and settlements with local political subdivisions and special districts. Apparently, Teva, Allergan, CVS, Walgreens, and Walmart are required to pay, participate in these settlements, and the deadline to participate in getting some of the money for this is April 18th. So I thought, all right, I'll navigate through, and then it got to a point where I had to do an electronic signature, and I thought, well, maybe I better check to see if I'm authorized to sign anything. So I sent an email up to Assistant Prosecutor Chrissy Ryan, asking her that, I wasn't sure if it was legitimate. I didn't know if it was a scam, so I asked her if I said I wasn't comfortable proceeding until I had your opinion. And I enclosed the signature disclosure statement for her to review. I didn't know if maybe she had any experience with other townships. Her reply back was, I do not believe you can sign off on these without authorization from the trustees, as it involves signing on to the settlement of a legal claim. I think this is a new case separate from the previous one, One Ohio settlement, but we'll have to look into this further. We're the first township to ask her about this, but she was going to reach out to the other townships to see if they received them. And I did talk to the fiscal officer of South Russell. They got a similar email, and apparently this other One Ohio settlement, they received some money. And I think the county has set up a group for the distribution of the money, because the intent is that whatever money is received will go to benefit those that are addicted to opioids and that. So maybe the sheriff's department or the schools, but we could be entitled. So I don't know if you want me to.
I'll make a motion to authorize Dan.
What's the time frame on this? How soon does this have to be done?
April 18th.
April 18th?
I have to submit the application.
When is the quarterly dinner?
The 13th? It's next week.
Thursday.
The
13th?
Thursday.
Is it?
Yeah, but, Gene, if we put off doing this,
I talked
to Chrissy about it as well, and I know Chester's already been given an amount. It's not huge. It's going to be well south of $1,000. But it's not nothing either. You know, if you guys wait until the 17th to do that, Dan's like...
Well, the quarterly dinner's on the 12th.
I know, but we can't authorize him. If we don't do it tonight, we can't do it until the 17th, and the deadline's the 18th.
All
so
right.
That's okay. Tight.
We're going to authorize him to sign and apply for it.
Sure.
We don't even have to accept it if we don't want it.
Wait a second.
I'll second.
Gene's second.
DJ?
Yes.
G?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
I know the fire department has logged some costs with
some
opioid.
That hasn't been real bad.
Yeah.
That's all I have. Mm-hmm.
All right. That's, we just mentioned the bid opening on the 7th up here at 10:05 a.m. BZA's in here next week. Township Quarterly's next week. Anybody else to address the board tonight?
I think we need to have our first energy rep come to our meeting. I think we all get the fact that it's been windy, but over the past year, their response time
has been pitiful.
Horrible. So, 2 weeks ago, we had a bad storm. Auburn Road, I was without power for 29 hours. There was a power line down over here and across somebody's driveway. They never showed up till Sunday. Saw one truck, then three trucks. Looked like they were doing something. I'm driving by, ask them, how soon do you think the power will be on? We don't know, we're waiting for our dispatcher. They're sitting in their trucks, just sitting there waiting.
They have to first of all make sure that the lines are closed down. We had the same scenario happen on another road that we were working on.
They fixed the line.
No, we actually went up and the guys were sleeping in the truck on Valley Road because they didn't get, well, they're on site,
mm-hmm.
and they need the call where they can shut the power down there. So, and through the grid, the way they, with the fusible links, is how they isolate. And
yeah.
Could you get permission to isolate?
So sure, it's... Jonathan?
I was out for 3 days, so...
Jonathan, J-O-N-A-T-H-A-N. Last name Tucker, T-U-C-K-E-R. So, it's... Again, I get it because it's windy. You know, what's going to happen. But it just seems like the responsiveness of First Energy has been very bad of late.
I got the thing on my phone like everybody else did.
I just...
120,000 people were without power. So when you're talking about the response time and 120,000 people are out,
I get that. But where are they positioning people? How many crews are assigned to this particular area? And it's always Auburn Road that seems to lose power, right?
Yep, that's correct.
Okay, it's getting old. Okay, so. I get the fact that the line was down here. I understand that. This time, I didn't see anything along Auburn Road. I went, Saturday went up the road, and all I saw was this one tree. I got a picture of it, too. Picture, you know, taking pictures while I'm driving. And you could see the tree, and I don't know if it was just on the northern part of Auburn Township or just...
It's the very northern part, almost over the line.
Yeah. I got a pic, and literally, it was pulling down on the power line, and it was definitely landing on the telephone lines.
The one 2 weeks ago was down between Stafford and Franks.
Mm-hmm.
That was pretty bad.
So, I mean, the other thing that's concerning to me is not only, you know, you can call in a problem, and you can actually leave a phone number. I do that now. That's unreliable, because after my power came on Saturday around 9, I finally got a phone call at 10:30. They also have a texting thing now, which I got a text. They said, your power's been back on. No, it wasn't. You go to their website, you'll see something that says, estimation restored at 4 o'clock. A couple hours later, nope, severe weather, we don't know when. They're doing their customers a lot of a disservice. In fact, like I said, I took pictures, or better yet, go to their website. This is great. I love their website, what it says here. Good energy is reliable service. It's the biggest bunch of bull I've ever heard. Okay. But like I said, I took pictures, and I was even taking pictures of their website. And Auburn Township this past weekend had 75% of the community supposed it was out. And then a couple hours later, all of a sudden, Bainbridge was pretty much fixed, and we were still over 1,000 people. So all I'm asking here is I think they need to come out. They need to explain to the community. First of all, I really would like to know what grid Auburn is on, because apparently this whole township is on different grids.
Absolutely.
It's totally unreliable. Like I said,
it's amazing.
We'll be out of power here for hours. East Washington's fine. At least I can go up to the hitching post and get gas for my generator. Or Taylor May is fine. But it's always Auburn Road. And I think they need to explain to us where their biggest problem areas are and what are they doing about that to make the system more robust. This is getting ridiculous now. It really is. And now you're scaring me because I'm not going to get my generator from Portland for probably about a year. But it's becoming...
I know the power comes in from all different... My power actually comes from Aurora.
Yeah. But, and...
And I have to tell you, and I was telling Diane before the meeting started, in the 50s and the 60s, if it looked like rain, we didn't have power here for a week, sometimes longer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it just had to look like rain.
Yeah.
Since they brought a new trunk line down Mund that hits my end of the town, my power very rarely goes yeah. out. So I realize we're all on different grids and different... TJ, you're out most... When I'm still on, you're out almost all the time.
There was a time that we were like that, and then Johnson Rubber, Johnsonite up here, put in a couple of new machines, and they had to upgrade that entire...
That was the tree.
Stafford yeah. Road line. And we were
the tree.
Real reliable on this particular winter, but I can show you where the trees fell on the wires.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Just random, you know, but we've had three significant outages this winter, but I yeah. understand why, you know. When a 200-year-old tree falls on an electric yeah. wire, it's probably going to take it down.
Yeah. Well, part of the problem is, too, you got cable wires, you got telephone wires yeah. on electric poles, and they flat out refuse to respond.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we have called AT&T, the zoning office has called AT&T about wires being down, and it's taken weeks to get it fixed, and first of all, they denied it was their wires. Yeah. And I said, don't tell me it's not your wires. I went on the pole, it says AT&T right on the pole. Call CEI, they verify it. And you guys should well know after the project we did on Stafford Road about how they wouldn't cooperate with CEI when CEI was putting the new poles in, right? I mean, they wouldn't, the cable, so, that there will, you can drive right down, you can drive between here and 306, and I guarantee you there's 10 places where trees yeah. are laying on cable oh. and telephone lines right now today.
Right up the street.
Right up the street
yeah.
here.
And they're not little. They're not little no. trees either. You yeah. know, and well, that well. Doesn't help CEI because sooner or later, that's going to put undue pressure on a pole and bring something down, you know. And it,
something else that's also a concern here, too, I'm sure you can drive around and see it. When First Energy came around and cut a lot of the trees along the top of the wires, if you look at how they did it, there are some trees that literally the whole side of it is over the road, and all the weight of that tree is on the one side. One of these days, that tree is going to go down, and it's going to hit somebody's car. Mm-hmm. It's going to happen. So what I'm asking is, I think First Energy needs to come, explain themselves to the community. I want to see a grid map. I want to see what grid is Auburn Road on compared to all the other ones. So at least we understand what we're dealing with here. And then I want to know from them, where are your hot spots for all the trouble? And what are you doing to make it more robust?
They've had First Energy's had a lot of turnover with their government rep people, and that's who you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Also, the guy from Bainbridge.
Though. Yeah, we can certainly invite them out again. Mm-hmm. I think it'd probably be something to do a little networking at this township quarterly, right? Because it's not isolated to Auburn. That's for
oh,
sure.
But Parkman and Troy got nailed.
Yeah, well,
and they're still
even,
out.
Even on East,
yeah.
they went out into Pennsylvania.
But the only,
I was in Girard, Ohio, that nobody had power.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah, I heard that.
So, but what's interesting, like I said, is that all the years I lived here, I mean, it's getting worse, and that's why I got to call Portman Electric. I'm done with it. I told him, like, that's it, we're done. Because I travel for business, so I'm always worried about her plugging things in, stuff like that. The last power outage killed my septic pump. And the guy, and I just had it fixed today, the guy told me, he said, yeah, these constant on-offs and zapping. Part of the problem is because First Energy has put in something called, like a resetter, I think they call it.
Yeah. Three bangs and it's out.
Yeah, boom, boom, boom. What a lot of people, and I'm an electrical engineer, what a lot of people don't realize is when you get that boom, there's a lot of surge current that's coming into your house, and that's what damages things. And all they're doing by this constant resetting is potentially damaging more appliances in your home than what that thing is worth.
And the other thing, understand those trees that you see that are pruned so funny, but the okay, there are, and Emmerich will back me up on this, there are people that will figuratively, not literally, but figuratively, chain themselves to those trees because those are the bad generation.
And you know,
my kids used to swing in that tree.
I hear you. I'll tell you something, though. My wife says, why doesn't First Energy or some of these other utility companies start charging people from when those freaking trees hit the lines and it causes everybody to be out, and they refuse to have those trees taken down for free by those public utilities. They need to be feeling the pain of what they're causing to the rest of the community.
I wouldn't argue with that.
And I felt bad. There was these two ladies that we met at the Beartown Lakes. They just moved up from Florida because they got tired of the heat down there. These poor old ladies had no generator, and they just bought food and lost power because they live right down the street here. So we got to get their attention because we're the 21st century people. And this, and you mentioned to me once, too, this grid was built in the 50s, and they're doing nothing about it. Nothing.
So when do we want to have them come out and tell us what we want to know?
Why don't we call and see when they can come and give your number to one of us, and then we'll call you and let you know when they're coming.
Yeah, please.
They used to come around. They used to come around.
Yeah, they came last year, remember?
They used to come around here all the time because you started coming to the meetings.
Because every time they fix something, all they're doing is band-aiding the problem. They're not getting to the root cause of the problem, which, in my opinion, is one, they are not investing in improving the infrastructure. Two, I don't think they have enough crews. I don't think they have enough people anymore, like so many other companies. And as a result of that, communities, whether it's Auburn or is suffering.
I think Majorca is in charge of it, and he just refuses to say that it is a problem. Never mind, that was a bad joke.
They've done that before.
They sub out a lot of that tree work to Pennline now, various other companies. But I got to tell you, I was coming home Saturday evening from out east, and I saw four bucket trucks, all with CEI First Energy stickers on them. I haven't seen that in a long time.
No.
Their own crew. Because usually they sub out.
They were down on Valley Road, too.
I heard, Alice, so my kid was up.
When they closed the road yesterday.
We need to make some noise. We really
three of them there then.
Well, we'll work on this next week.
Thank you. I really do appreciate it.
What liability is there for a utility company for causing, you know, on account of causing these surges? And, you know, it's true. We've realized that for years. Well, we are, that these on and off surges, they do. They destroy furnaces, they destroy... You know, they impair the operation of anything.
I gotta think if it happens during a storm like we've been having, those are acts of God. So
it's what's called inrush current. If you're an engineer, know what that is.
Is that when it goes over to 35?
It just goes boom. I mean, just constant boom. It's the inrush of current in your home when they constantly are just resetting. It's like I mean, I've gotten to the point where if the power goes out, I'm just going to plug in things so damn fast.
I ruin my circuit breakers. I turn off my well pump. I turn off the hot water tank. Anything that's drawn, you have to get into practice again.
Yeah, that's what we started
because
doing.
Because I lost my utilities like you're talking.
Yeah.
November 1996, 7 days without power. So it's got me better.
I got a transfer switch. Because for my portable generator, I switch it because I was so afraid of the damage.
So they did notify
you. So I appreciate
turn everything off. So
I do appreciate you listening to me. I know I've been here before, bitching and moaning the same thing.
They used to come out. They used to come
but
out.
But it's getting.
They did.
It's getting. It's getting ridiculous now. And now with Wednesday, another potential windstorm. It's like, here we go again.
Get your candles out.
You
know,
they don't even read their meters anymore.
The face.
No, actually, all the meters have got this IP over power now.
Yeah.
So their metering information is now carried through the internet protocol over their power lines. It's not done through... Because the only way I found out my power was really on, I went to the address. Boom, IP's. It's on. And also listen for generators sitting down here. When it turns off, I don't know. But...
Well, we'll get a hold of the government reps that they send out to talk to folks like us, like you.
Okay.
And we'll see if we can get them here. But we'll work on this from a countywide angle.
Yeah. And please ask them when they come here to provide a layout of how Auburn is set up on the grid and where certain roads is getting their power.
I think that might be classified.
Yeah. It might be.
Oops.
Never.
It would be interesting.
We gotta push. No, we have some. I think they need to tell us. I don't know why it's. I don't know why it's classified.
I don't know.
Right, we're paying a lot more money for the on the electric bills, and it's getting worse.
I guarantee it's going to go up in June too.
Of course.
They already said.
Yes. Anyway, thank you very much for your time. I'll give you my phone number.
Anybody else tonight? Anybody else?
And good job this winter. Thank you very, very much.
Looking for the ultimate.
That's just it. It's my snowblower.